real prospect that he may be the first president in quite some time to face the real prospect of jail time.
The president has now stepped into the same territory that ultimately led to President Nixon resigning the office.
Certainly they'd be impeachable offenses because they were committed in the service of fraudulently obtaining the office.
Boy, that sounds pretty ominous, doesn't it?
Wow, let's bring in Dan Bongino, former NYPD officer, former Secret Service agent, and author of Spygate, The Attempted Sabotage of Donald J. Trump. Good morning to you. Glad we're bringing up your book because the title is basically what we're talking about. They want to lock him up. They want to push jail time on him. You hear all these Democrats on the Sunday shows. What's your reaction?
You know, Ainsley, this is really scary stuff. I'm not exaggerating for effect on television here. I don't think anybody needs to do that anymore. It's not just that, you know, in the book I cover the scheme and the malfeasance and misfeasance and potential criminality used to take down Donald Trump. Mm-hmm. It's not just that they're apparently now going to get away with some of that. It's that they are actively doubling down on police state tactics. I mean, let's look at what they did. You may say, oh, come on, Dan, the police state, the Democrats, that's a little much. Is it really? Are we sure? Let's look at things we know they did. They unmasked private American citizens' phone calls. They were listening in on American citizens' phone calls without a warrant. Legal, but the reasoning questionable at best. They tapped into the NSA database. We know that. We've had a FISA court disclosure saying that. We had to misuse the FISA process to spy on Americans who still have not been prosecuted for any crime. Carter Page, explain to me again how this isn't police state tactics. And now they're doubling down and they want to throw the president in jail? You know, for what? For civil violations?
Yeah. Would you say the latter half is all true? But just to stay on this and what came down in the Cohen documents. The dramatic way in which they postured the need for transparency so the powerful and the wealthy don't rule the election process. I understand it by talking to lawyers that this is usually very dry stuff, X, Y, Z. Now they're putting all these adjectives to describe the need for transparency when it comes to the election process. Let's drill down on it. There were two women coming forward that were going to say negative things about the president and relations. If you are running for office, whether it's a bad business deal where you have a bitter partner, you want to make sure that things are going the best you can to keep everything on your eye on the ball and think on the issues that are going to have a thumbs up, a thumbs down in the election. So these things come out there. He evidently, Michael Cohen, writes checks for over $100,000 to two women. Now, that's a election law violation. Now, according to everybody's stats, in 2008, Barack Obama's campaign spent nearly $2 million in illegal election in violations of election law. They got a fine of $300,000. But you want to throw this president in jail about payments to women that he may or may not have known about that dwarfed the $2 million? We should just accept that?
Yeah, there's a lot in what you just said. What you said is factually correct. The Barack Obama team was guilty of the exact same thing and was given a civil fine of, I think it was $375,000 or
$300,000.
$375,000. But because it's Barack Obama, you know, the anointed one, nothing happened. And the media, of course, there was no clamoring to have him thrown in jail. Now, on your first point about how the prosecuting documents, which me as a former federal agent, I'm involved in many federal cases, you just nailed it. They are never written like that. They are written with a Joe Friday, just the facts, ma'am, approach. Why is this written like some kind of elongated, romance novel here? And the reason's very simple, Brian. This prosecutor is not looking for a criminal prosecution against Trump, I don't believe. He's looking to tell a story to the Democrat Congress that they can use for impeachment. And that story needs details that are not legally necessary, but it needs it to tell a political story during their impeachment. That's exactly what this prosecutor's doing.
And make him so politically radioactive by the time he runs for re-election, they'll say, okay, if he gets the nomination, you can't put him in office again.
But ultimately,
you just won the prize. You just nailed it. That is exactly what he's doing.
And it becomes a question, hey, I thought this was all about Russia. Where's the collusion stuff? It's not there. James Comey, when he sat down with the House investigators on Friday, he admitted that the dossier, which was essentially the basis for the FISA application being granted, they didn't know whether or not it was true. Mr. Ratcliffe said, do you recall that on numerous occasions subsequent to October 21st, 21st of 2016, you, in your capacity as FBI director, referred to the Steele dossier as salacious and unverified. And Mr. Comey said, yes, I don't know that I was referring to all of it. Maybe I was, but I had in mind some particular portions of it that were salacious and unverified. So the very foundation of the case, unverified.
You know, Steve, it pains me to say it, but Jim Comey has a real problem with the truth. He seems to have a very severe, like, Benadryl-like allergy. He's going to need an EpiPen when he tells the truth. He has now backtracked on his comments that when Mike Flynn spoke to the FBI investigators, they thought he wasn't being deceptive. He's backtracking on that. Now he's trying to backtrack on this, what we just brought up about the dossier being unverified. This should shake every American's faith in the, I want to be clear on the distinction, on the upper management of the FBI. The men and women I worked with were great. But the upper management of the FBI under Jim Comey, thankfully many who've resigned or been fired, this is an epic, I mean, generational level of incompetence here. You may not see this kind of ridiculousness again. That they didn't verify the dossier? You guys understand what this means, right?
Yes.
They brought a bunch of information into court. They swore to it with their
political
right hands.
Political opposition research.
And nobody knew it was true. And they're on there, and nobody thinks this is a problem in the media. The FBI director just told you, we're not even sure this was true. Do you know where this could go? This is third world police state nonsense.
Well, the other
There's
thing
no
is,
question about it.
He was asked about Peter Strzok. He said, well, if I saw those text messages, I would have pulled him off the case. They later said, do you think he showed bias and shouldn't be pulled off the case? He goes, no, I don't see any bias in those text messages. Really? He calls him every vile name in the book to Lisa Page, and he talked about how unacceptable he is, and talked about an insurance plan, but he sees no bias in it. Either he is acting like the King of England in the FBI, totally divorced from any of their policies and procedures, or he's being intentionally inaccurate.
Brian, he's either the greatest manipulator in the history of the FBI, or he's an outright liar. There is no option C here. And then you just brought up another one. We missed this one. He also said he wasn't sure that Christopher Steele was the source of the dossier. Wait, what? You get this information about a potential president during the campaign committing treason with the Russians, and you don't think to ask, hey, who said that? Oh, no, don't worry. It was the guy in the corner in the bagel shop. He told me, you know the guy with the tinfoil cap? You didn't think to ask where this came from? It's an obnoxious level of incompetence. Jim Comey should be embarrassed.
Well,
this guy clearly is either a liar or incompetent.
He's not.
When he goes back in a week or two, let's just hope he takes an EpiPen. All right, Mr. Bongino, thank you very
Thanks,
much.
Dan.
He's going to need it. See you later.
All right, let's hand it over to Carly.